Sound louder or something?
No, everything is clear. So thank you for joining me on this interview. I know you're in a very serene, quiet vacation home right now. Is it not?
It's our second home in the hills. We just managed to get here before the lockdown.
Yeah.
So we've been here 2 months. But 2 months of serenity also can get too much.
I read your piece in HT. I think about 5 to 10 days after the lockdown, you'd written it. How it's getting to you. Are you feeling better now?
I'm feeling better now because I've started writing, which I wasn't doing earlier. I was feeling too restless to write. So once you start writing, then anywhere is good.
That's true. So there was a question for the end of the chat, but since you
Oh,
mentioned
sorry.
it's something,
I didn't
no,
mean
that's
to hear.
fine. Are you working on something new?
Well, I am. I'm working on, I just realized that in difficult times, everybody loves fantasy. Like, have you seen the amount of people watching Ramayana? I mean, the whole world, I mean, all the Indians all over the world are watching. So I also started watching Mahabharata and Ramayana again. And, I don't know if I've written a children's Ramayana
Of
some
course,
time ago. So I've just started a series of fantasy stories for young adults. It's called Fantastic Tales for Not So Young. I mean, that's the title,
wow.
working title. So I have a lovely editor, Sudeshna Shom, at Talking Cub, and she's always very enthusiastic about, whatever crazy idea I have.
Of
So I've
course.
just done two stories, and what I'm going to do is, though it's fantasy, it's going to be a little bit of information about the environment. Wherever I've set the story, like of course the first one I've set in Himachal in the mountains, in a forest, so that the reader will get a little bit of information. He might not even know he's getting this information.
Of course. So, you mean series as in
Well,
full
it's
book?
a collection of short stories
Correct.
initially to
Short
start with.
stories. Oh. I feel like that's a nice piece by piece sort of thing to write and read.
Yeah, and it's got me into a better frame of mind, to so that I can escape into this fantasy world. So if I, I am enjoying it, and I hope the children will enjoy it.
I'm definitely sure they will. And speaking of escaping to fantasy world, I just finished Murder in Shimla, and it is, I find it's the perfect lockdown read because it has this little world. It's gossip, it's drama, bitchiness, pettiness among especially the beginning. People are just like thinking, oh, what was she wearing and what was she doing and how much she was drinking. And I found it such a beautiful far. I finished it in a day, even though I had so much other work. I enjoyed it.
It's sort of easy, quick read. I've done another one called Murder in Goa. I don't know if you read that. That's also very, like, you read it very fast.
Yeah, I am definitely going to procure it. It was
Penguin. It's
such
published by Penguin.
a fun read. It's such a fun read. Are you also reading something during in at
At the moment, well, you won't believe it. I just finished a very tough, heavy book, Hilary Mantel's
Oh.
The Mirror and the Light. It's a trilogy. It's
Yeah.
Wolf Hall.
Yeah.
First one, Wolf Hall. The second was Bring Up the Bodies, and this is the third one. It's Thomas Cromwell's life. And she's very dense writing. It's beautiful. It's really so. I was so exhausted by that, especially in the lockdown. Already you're sort of like
Absolutely.
feeling. I'm in a beautiful place. I've sent you
Yeah,
photographs.
it was so beautiful.
So now I've gone back to reading something very light. I'm reading my favorite Agatha Christie again,
Of course.
and I'm reading Alice in Wonderland because I want to also get into the fantasy
Fantasy
myth.
frame of mind. Yeah, so you mentioned Agatha Christie, and of course I was going to begin our chat with, what's your relationship with the mystery genre itself? You've written three, I think, Murder in a
Just
Middle-aged
two, just two.
Kid. Oh, so I must have got the
Well, the earlier one is a book I wrote called Tailor of Giripoli. So that sort of had, it was about this place where I live,
Yeah.
and that was mainly between the relationship between city people who have homes here and the village people. I just wanted to explore that because it's in India, it's, as you know,
yeah,
you know, people really don't care, even if they're their neighbors, but if they're not people like you, educated, Western, slightly, you know, English speaking, you don't really bother.
Mm.
And it's the other way around too. They're not interested in you either because they think you're a waste of time. So I wanted to explore that very fragile, complex relationship. So Tailor of Giripool was the first book. Mm-hmm. And there, while writing, suddenly I decided I'll put a little, one dead body in it. a little bit of solving. So a lot of people, when they read it, thought it was a murder mystery.
Yeah.
But it's not really.
Okay. So what's your relationship with the genre?
Straightforward murder mystery like mine.
Fair.
So I might do another one. You know, city based. I'm really enjoying doing exploring a city and doing it. So next one will be based in Delhi. So you know, all the different colonies in Delhi and the kind of smooth. Have you ever lived in North India?
Unfortunately, only Mumbai.
Well, Mumbai doesn't have that, but you know, Delhi, like a tribal sort of thing.
Is
everybody,
it?
Wherever you live, where did you go to school, immediately, you know, you'll be classified into one little tribe and you'll
I feel, yeah, it's there a little bit in Mumbai. Sometimes, you know, if you're from Bandra, if you're from South Bombay, there is that bit of, oh, you're a Bandra person or you're a Sobo person.
Right. But in Delhi, it's very, very strong because, you know, Bombay is full of professional people and people come from all over India to work there, and they respect that, and it matters to them where you work much more than
that's probably
where you live. But in Delhi, the first question you'll be asked is, where do you live? And you know, from there, everything will, you know, will be whole life will depend on where you live. So I just want to make fun of that.
So you're writing two things simultaneously.
I haven't started that. I've just got a draft. Yeah. Oh. I have to finish this. I want to finish this book first and then work on that.
But as a reader,
I have two, three things. Sorry.
That is amazing. No, that's amazing how you multitask, not just writing. I think even artist, storytelling for kids, your artwork, of that, you know, it's amazing. How do you manage time and creative flow? Don't you get exhausted sometimes?
No, I don't. I get a real high from, you know, working with children. I get tired writing. Cool. Writing I find very exhausting. And after some time, you know, I really sort of, I have to force myself. I'm a great procrastinator. I keep doing this, doing that. And then finally, I'll sit down to write because I know I have to finish something. But with art and with working with children, it's I can do it all the time, anytime. And it's very flexible because I don't work for any organization.
Correct.
I have but I've worked with so many NGOs in Delhi mostly.
Yeah.
And they know when I'm in Delhi and they get in touch and they said, will you come and do this? And you know, we just have a couple of days of great fun working with the kids. And
it's
and
very easy going.
It's a sharing process. I'm not teaching them anything. Correct. They're just working together.
It's very easy going in that sense.
Yeah. I keep it easy going because, you know, children in Indian schools, whether they go to government schools or they go to, you know, very expensive school, there's so much stress of
so true
being good. You have to be the best.
True.
And in art, I try to break that down and say, you don't have to be the best. Just enjoy. You know? And very small children do that. You know, if you're below six, you'll really enjoy the process.
Yeah.
And you won't care whether I like it or some the teacher likes it, he'll just paint and he'll go off happily. But after six, it becomes, is my painting the best? Will I get a prize?
That is, I think I've gone through it as a child when I was growing up. Like, completely relate, and it's wonderful that you're doing this with kids. But speaking of mystery, coming back to Murder in Shimla, which is the highlight for today, which it has beautiful cover. I feel I just want to share with the viewers the cover. It's so beautiful. Have you ever thought about illustrating your covers?
Yeah, the cover is wonderful, isn't it? I think, you know, Speaking Tiger, all their covers are really good. May I show you my other book? It's a children's book.
Yes.
Yeah, I've seen the cover, how beautiful it is. Now, these are my drawings, but they put it together.
Oh, okay. These are all correct.
So beautiful. Yeah. Sorry, I set an alarm for you.
Oh,
so yeah. No, they have a very good design team. Mm-hmm. I tell you, who's done the cover? Is it written there? I'd like to mention who got the cover. Who's done the cover?
I also have
cover design. Yeah, cover design and illustration is by Saurabh Garg.
Oh, Saurabh Garg happens to be my partner on Purple Pencil Project. Not the same.
Oh my God. Ajah, okay. Yeah.
Same Garg. I would have illustrated a book, but okay. No, that's very nice of you to mention him. So what mystery books, besides Agatha Christie, you mentioned her, what are the mystery books you've grown up reading or enjoyed reading and, you know, inspired you to write this?
Well, I've grown up reading, of course, Agatha Christie, because my mother used to read a lot. And I'm Bengali, as you know. And, you know, in Bengal, there's been a great tradition of detective writing, and like Bomkesh Bakshi and Peluda and all. So my grandmother used to read them in Bengali, and she'd often tell me stories about, I couldn't read Bengali, but she would, and then I think they were not translated. Now I can read it in very good translation. So, I mean, this whole mystery thing was great fun always. And Simla again, my grandparents lived in Simla. My mother was born in Simla. So stories about Simla, we're always there in the family, sort of, you know, when you sit down at the dining table and discuss something, oh, remember what happened in Simla, so-and-so got murdered. And in my family, I think most Bengali families do this. They love these kind of gory stories about who got murdered and who.
Is that so?
And there was a theft and all that. They love all that storytelling. So I think somewhere in my head, stayed.
Yeah,
I think I didn't start writing till quite late. I was a painter. I mean, I'm still a painter.
Yeah.
So I only started writing about what is what 20 years ago? 15, 20 years.
Yeah.
For you, probably, you know, I don't know how old you are, but it seems a long time.
Yeah. I'm 26, so I think
there you are. So, you know, when you're 6 years old, I started writing.
Yeah. I'm lucky that you did and I got to get introduced to your work. So, you know, you mentioned interviews before and you've also just said that you've said in the interviews that India stories are like a low hanging fruit. And, you know, you just mentioned how your family also had a great storytelling culture. So was this particular tale also something that was out, like, you know, what inspired this murder in Shimla's particular narrative and tale, an incident, or, you know, how did that come about?
Well, murder in Shimla, I'll tell you, I thought about it long time ago, even before I became a writer. Ooh. I always thought, I was talking to somebody and I said, you know, these stories I'd heard, I remember my mother telling me about this Englishman who'd, you know, whose wife had murdered him and then they found him much later and then they hushed it up. You know. And that was many, many years ago. I wasn't a writer. I wasn't even planning to be a writer. But like I told you, you know, things just stay in the air. And sometimes, so after I wrote The Goa Murder, which I was commissioned to write, you know, murder mystery, set in a city, like a city-based murder mystery. Mm-hmm. After I finished writing that, I said, okay, this is the time to bring out that old story about that English, poor Englishman who'd been killed. But when I sat down to write, all the similar stories over the years came into place because my mother-in-law also lived in Simla and she used to talk to me about the kind of class distinction in Simla between the British families, leave alone the Indians. I mean, they were okay with the Indians, but amongst themselves, like if you notice in Murder in Simla, they don't like
the
girl who's murdered because she's not one of them.
Yeah.
You know, she's of unknown parentage. And,
yeah.
And even in that little family, they don't like Elizabeth because she's not upper class, you know. So all these little...
Yeah.
And of course, the inspector is Indian. That is another problem with them. So all this one had heard growing up. Anybody who's lived in Delhi, you see what happened was the government, and my grandfather worked for the government, they all went up to Simla for 6 months.
Okay.
March, April, there was an exodus, and all of Delhi went up to Simla because the government moved.
Okay.
And then they'd all come back in October.
Oh.
So this, again, was, you know, quite an interesting fact. I haven't gone in too much details in the book because already so much happening.
Yeah. No, still, even then, it was very, it evoked, you know, those Victorian novels I have read. It evoked some of the drama and some of the social equations and dynamics of those novels. Not just Victorian, but even if 1920s New York High Society, for instance. You know, it evoked that same
class. Yes.
Yeah, the same class differences that you pointed out. But I wanted to, what is this? So specifically, why the British era?
Because Simla and, you know, British, the Raj season was very interesting. And I've read a lot about Simla. I love Simla. You know, there's a lot of old books. There's a beautiful secondhand bookshop in the Simla Mall. And over there, I'm constantly, whenever I go to Simla, I go there and buy books. So, you know, about Simla trees, about Simla has been very well documented.
Yeah.
So it was easy in a way, you know, to get into that storytelling, you know, picking up from here, there, and then and putting it together in my own way.
Was the ultimate sort of...
written about a lot from Kipling, you know, right? From Kipling's time.
Yeah. It's been,
even before that, Emily Eden, whoever came to India during that time, wrote a lot about Simla.
Yeah.
So that's more than Delhi. You have more material on Simla, I think. Than,
is that true?
The social structure.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Are there books you read that you can recommend to some of our, to our readers, viewers?
Yes, you can read an author called Charles Allen. And he writes a lot about Simla, Plain Tales from the Raj and Plain Tales from the Hills. So Charles Allen, you can read. Then there's Neville Tully in India. He's based in, he lives in Simla. Then, of course, the Kipling and Emily Eden. She writes. Then there was Edward Lear, who's a painter. Uh-huh. He traveled in India a lot. You know, during the early part of the century, though Edward Lear was last century, they used to come to India and they used to paint and then they used to go back and sell all the watercolors.
Yeah, I heard that.
So he also came to Simla. So, you know, Simla was just very romantic. Even now, if you talk to any of my English friends, Simla to them is immediately something very...
Does it still retain some of that romantic charm as a city? I've never been there, so I don't know. But you've lived...
It doesn't at all. It's very crowded. It's the capital of Himachal Pradesh. Yeah. So it's extremely crowded. Unless you go off season, like if you go sometime and there are no tourists, then it's still quite, it's you know, the architecture is very beautiful, but it's very crowded and there's traffic jams all the time. So, unfortunately,
people who want to travel to Simla, go off season.
Go beyond Simla. You know, you can go to Nal Dera or you can go to Mashobra, you know, things which as little places which are higher than Simla. Simla is a big town.
Yeah, it's become a little mainstream, maybe.
Yeah, like Bangalore. Bangalore perched on the hills. Except the views are still beautiful. You know, the Himalayas are still beautiful.
Nice.
And when clouds clear, you see this range of mountains.
Yeah, I hear the pictures. I mean, I was just... Since I live in Chicago right now, the city, my only view is the parking garage.
Oh.
Of my apartment. So I was very interested in just staring at the picture for 5 minutes.
But, where I am now, I'm on another hill. Simla is sort of somewhere far away there.
Oh.
So if I drive for about 4 or 5 hours over the hill, I'll get to top of Simla. There is an open path. And I took it many years ago. It's quite a narrow road and it's very bad. I haven't been since.
Oh, well, hope we all get the chance someday to visit these
come
off.
To Simla. Or you can come to me, because everybody who comes to me says that this Simla must have been like this at one time when the British first went. I've mentioned that also in the book, how Simla was found. I've not found, I mean, Simla was already there. How the British...
Governor, yeah, how the first house was built, and then the viceroy's house, yeah. Yeah, that's fascinating. So did you have an idea of the end in a murder mystery? I feel like that's such an important part of a murder mystery. But I think every writer approaches it, you know, some just let the story develop. Some may have, okay, this is going to be the culprit in the end. What was your approach like?
Well, initially I started with, I thought, okay, this is how it's going to go. It was very structured, and I wrote, this is how it's going to end, and this is... But of course, it all fell apart, and you know, the things, it always happens to me. Whenever I'm trying to write something structured, it falls apart and it takes its own life. The characters do exactly what they want to, and it's total chaos. But somehow it comes together. And of course, I had very good editors, you know, Renuka Chatterjee. She really sort of put it all together. You know, you need a good editor, because what happens, especially with this genre, unless it's very tight, and when you're writing, you don't realize, you know, you're going all over the place. At least I go. And then somebody has to bring it all together.
So what was I don't know if that's a spoiler, but what was the alternative ending, the first ending that you had envisioned?
Well, I had actually thought of very complicated. It was very complicated about, you know, who the murdered girl was. And I wanted actually William Parker to be the murderer, but that wasn't working out in this way. He's still involved. He's still a bad guy, but
yeah,
he hasn't got his hands dirty.
Yeah, absolutely. So organizing, I've attempted to write. I have ideas which I do half sketched. And the one thing, and even my writer friends, the one thing we found challenging is how to maintain our notes. And, you know, approaching writing, how do you maintain notes and stuff, plot consistency and things like that. Do you have a specific method or software you use, especially for something like a murder mystery? I believe that would be of paramount importance.
I didn't know there was a software. I'd love to. I'd love to make life so easy. Please let me know when you find it.
There's one is Granthik. I think Vikram Chandra's sort of co-founded it. That's one.
Granthika.
Granthika.
Oh, great.
Like timelines and character plotting and everything.
Oh, excellent. Oh, gosh. I just write it down at once.
I will message it.
No, I do it in a very, very sort of, unprofessional way. I have notebooks. Little notebooks. So I keep writing.
And it works.
This is done, and this is done. Of course, then it all gets messed up. And I tear the page, then I pin it up. And I wouldn't recommend my thing. I've just been very fortunate. I've had excellent editors who, you know, who put up with all this nonsense.
I was very curious, because mapping, like you say, it's mapping, writing a mystery is like mapping a math problem.
Math
so much. How much time did this take? I know it's been gestating in your head for so long.
It took me about 2 years. The Goa murder just took me 8.5 months. I just did it very fast. It's called Murder in the Happy Home for Aged. And I was in Goa. We spent winters in Goa. And there was this old people's home there. And I went to visit it one day. Just like that, I thought, you know, maybe I'll do some art or something like that. And there was such a fun lot of people sitting there, and they were drinking. They were not interested in doing any art or anything. And they were gossiping with each other and gossiping about. So I thought, let's give them a murder to solve. But this one took much longer. This one took longer because I think I was a little ambitious, and whole the Raj bit had to come in, all the tension between the Indian police officer and the British family, all that had to come in. So
yeah,
this took much
I feel like
longer.
this could become a series. A murder in each city. You've done
Yeah.
Goa, you've done Shimla, now you want to do Delhi.
Well, a lot of my readers have suggested that I do another one with Mrs. Tweedy and Ramsin. So that I feel quite, you know, happy about that.
That
they like Ramsin a lot. So.
He is a very likable character.
Yeah, you're a good looking guy.
Yeah, you're 1940s, good looking Indian, right? He has a vibe to him, the dashing vibe. But I unfortunately haven't reviewed the book personally. One of our reviewers has, and she wanted to know, is Mrs. Tweedy what Miss Marple is to Agatha Christie? Could she be?
Yes, definitely. I mean, she's totally inspired by Miss Marple. And she's, I think, slightly, she reads much more and she's sort of, but she is a Miss Marple for India, I would say, for that time.
You should make it into a series. It's just like Agatha Christie had so many. Yeah.
But only thing is that with Ramsin and Mrs. Tweedy, I'll be stuck in 1940s, you know, because they're, I mean, Mrs. Tweedy is quite old.
Yeah.
So I could do one or two, but I, you know, they couldn't time travel. I'll have to kill off Mrs. Tweedy at some point, and Ramsin could go on.
I didn't think about it. It'd have to be, it will not be very modern, contemporary sort of. Is the Delhi one contemporary?
Yeah, Delhi one is totally based now. Yeah.
I'll be very interested to read all, like, you know, the tribal war that you were saying. They're saying and all. But speaking to
you now. The girl who, there's a young girl, young means, I mean, she's in her late 30s, and she's the one who actually is going to solve it. And her name is Neera Mukherjee, so she, which is my mother's name. So I just thought I'm going to put her into the...
Does it feel a little awkward sometimes to write about, you know, the names are similar, does it sometimes... Is the tendency to want to borrow from the person's trait also high? Does that happen as a writer?
Well, of course, it happens all the time. I mean, all writers, I'm surprised we have any friends left, because you're constantly, you know, we are all like magpies, you know, you're stealing all the time, stealing from each other. Not stealing, you know, you sort of say, oh, that sounds very good, let me use it. And it's often been said to me, I remember a writer friend of mine, and she said, oh, I like your name. I'm going to use it. So, you know, there you are. So
Well,
as long as you don't copy or you don't plagiarize or anything, but you get inspired. Like, I was totally inspired by Miss Marple, and I adore her.
Yeah.
I read all the books and I see all the television. I even have the old television series of Miss Marple, which BBC.
Yeah, there's a lot on. I feel like Agatha Christie's novels are so, all her characters, all her stories, there's so much that can be done with them also. You know, you can reimagine them as it's been done in TV across, I feel like, 4 decades now. Yeah. I have seen different versions of it as well.
But only thing with Agatha Christie, she's pretty, now if you read her now, she's pretty racist, you know, in her foreigners are always bad and anybody from the Middle East would always be suspect. So they, I think, have tried to sanitize, like Enid Blyton, they've tried to sanitize her, but not much. Luckily with Agatha Christie, after the war, she became much more, you know, she was quite conscious about writing anything bad about anybody.
But at least you see growth in her. Yeah, in Blyton, you don't see a growth. It's just problematic from across all her books, I feel.
I haven't been able to find any good detective series written in America as yet. Have you?
No, unfortunately.
Maybe we've grown up with British, you know,
crime
writing.
Yeah, no. And also, I feel in detective fiction, Scandinavian literature is very dominant.
Noir,
the noir, Scandinavian noir is very dominant.
But I don't write. In fact, you know, Alexander McCall Smith, he wrote that, you know, you can either write noir or you can write cozy murder mysteries. So what I write, what Murder in Shimla is a cozy murder mystery. There's not much blood, not much you're not frightened by, you know.
Yeah, it's not that kind. But are there any contemporary writers you read, mysteries, contemporary mystery writers you enjoy? Maybe in the Indian space, if you've come across anything good.
I've just read Bomkesh.
No, okay.
Sharanindu Bondhopadhyay, Bengali writer.
Yeah.
And he started writing in the 30s, and then he wrote till, I think, early, about till the 1950s or something.
Yeah,
he wrote.
Yeah.
And nobody else there. I've read Anita Nair, you know, her books also. She has an excellent inspector.
Yeah.
About his name, but he's again very, very interesting. Cut Like a Wound, I think.
Yeah, we check it up.
Then Kishwar Desai has also got this woman detective called Simran, who's very feisty.
Yeah.
So there are people, but there is not much, you know, not many of us. Like, I might do one book, and after that, I'll go back to writing. You know, I'm writing a travel memoir of my father's journey from East Bengal to Europe to India.
Oh wow!
So again for Speaking Tiger, and
you're digging into family archives for that.
Family archives, and I've been working on that for the last 4 years. In between, I keep writing these, you know, murder mysteries and children's books and all. But that book is sort of an ongoing travel. You know, it's a long journey.
That's so fascinating. I think family archives are my most favorite subject to think about
history.
I think mostly that. Because I don't have much. In my family, we don't have a lot of archival material and, you know, histories and stories. So I remember once I spoke, I think I was telling my mother, I was like, why don't we have partition stories? I want grandparents with the partition. And she was like, "Are you, what's demand that is of an heirloom?"
Yeah, that's I know. All Punjabi families have a, you know, partition. Everybody has a partition story.
So yeah. I only used to read about them in books or, you know, in
you grew TV. Up in Bangalore. Yeah.
I grew up in Mumbai and my family's from Gujarat. So Gujarat. Yeah. The only interesting thing was in 1950 somebody got divorced or something, and I was like,
oh God.
That is only that is why is that the only story in our family? What about the scandals? What about the struggles and the exploits and whatnot? Yeah. So I'm very that sounds fascinating, you know, digging into archive.
North has always been so turbulent, you know. So any
even
family,
Bengal. I think even Bengal for that.
Bengal even more, much more. Yeah. And even if there isn't, they will make sure that, you know, they discover something or the other. And there's all, at least my family is just so full of stories. My first book was called My Sainted Aunt. It was a book of aunts, you know, women in my family who traveled. And I don't know if you can get it. You'll get it on Amazon. My Sainted Aunts.
My Sainted Aunts. Oh, yeah. I remember. Yes, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's been reissued again by Women Unlimited. So you can...
That's amazing.
It's called Traveling with My Aunts. They've changed the title. There's some more stories, so... Oh. And there you see how much history there is, family history.
I must read that then. But besides writing, you're also an artist. And I'm always very curious how, you know, artists who function in multiple mediums, how those mediums sort of feed each other. I know bird watching for you has translated into both story and illustration. Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, how does your larger work as an artist and as a writer inspire each other?
Well, the way they inspire, I think so, is that, you know, I'm a visual writer. When I write something, I can see it. And I don't know if you notice.
Yeah, no.
It's very descriptive, my way of style of writing. And also allows me to break away. Like if I'm stuck in the middle of something, and you know, my mind is not working, I can always go back to painting. And, you know, same way, but though with I don't know how to do it. And then everything comes together when I work for children. I do something called story painting, which, you know, it combines storytelling and painting. So that works very well because children, you know, can switch very easily from words to images. And it I think it works And then there are a lot of artists, right? A lot of artists who enjoy
But those who don't paint, would you have tips on how to be a more visual writer? But I feel like sometimes when I'm reading some Indian authors, not all or not even many, but when I'm reading some of them, I feel like the visual vocabulary is rather weak. You know, things aren't described as well. Would you have some tips on how one can be a better visual storyteller when they're writing?
Well, you know, I'm always wary of giving advice because everybody sort of has their own journey and own way of writing. I mean, getting to a certain point or certain style. But what I would like to share is that I sometimes just shut my eyes and visualize, you know, like when I was writing about Murder in Simla, I mean, I was always in Simla. I was walking down the mall. I was talking to Ram Sen. I could see those shops. So just, you know, try and get, and if you can't visualize it, if you haven't been to that place, try and get some images, you know, photographs or wherever you placed your story. I also teach creative writing, you know, I do creative writing workshops in schools and things. Oh. And I just teach them this question of asking why. Why did this happen? When did this happen? How did this happen? So keep asking each other, you know, asking yourself. And also if you're doing a kind of a group session, then you can ask the whole group to visualize. And then you get different images from...
That's very interesting. A group sort of...
Try that. You get a group, you throw a story at them and then get them to write different thing, and you'll find like 10 images will come to you at once.
Well, that is a beautiful idea.
Yeah, you can do it in Chicago.
So we do online community writing session on Unblock. It's basically to tell the writer's block to go away. So unblocking the writer's block, that's the idea. You know, pushing each other to, so before the lockdown, before the pandemic, we used to have an offline session where 10, 12 people would come together. Sometimes an author would come moderate it and they would all write their own stories, but then share it with each other, give feedback. But this is a very interesting twist on, you know, writing on the same particular story.
I'm happy to do it with you anytime.
I would definitely announcing the next Unblock as we speak.
We can do a short story. It'll be great fun. Not a murder mystery, because murder mystery, you can't do a short story. Writing a short story is it's very challenging because you've only got that, you know, window to put everything in. You know, to throw all your, you know, whatever you have in your kitchen. So you have to put it. It's like cooking.
The murder mysteries are challenging to read also, especially now. Because you're so anxious to know. Or so eager, not anxious is the wrong word, but I was so eager to know. I was like, oh, this is, when will the next thing happen? I feel like, and I'm, I think maybe the age and the whole media generational thing, I've lost patience with certain acts. So, and I've not read a murder mystery in a while. So this was such a test in my patience. I was so tempted to just flip to the last chapter.
A lot of people do that, you know, they just go to the end.
Have you ever done that?
And work backwards. And then.
Have you ever done that?
No, I haven't. I can't. Even if I read the book and I know what's going to happen, like so many of these Agatha Christie's I've read hundreds of times, but I still like to go my pace and pretend I don't know.
No, it's a very enjoyable read. It's just that I had not read it this form in a while. No, mostly I've been reading academic books, especially for the last 8 months because I'm studying. So for me, this is an emotion I haven't gone through in a while, one can say.
Great, I'm glad that you know, I've in some way been responsible for doing.
Absolutely. So thank you, Bulbul, for taking time off during your writing and your artwork. And adjusting the schedule. And everyone, go read Murder in Simla. It's amazing. It's fun. It's frolic. It's dance, drama, everything. And a beautiful cover. I love it. I love a book with a good cover. And see you all next time.